Humanity is on the cusp of achieving immortality. Last week, three papers were published that outline a future that would have seemed like science fiction just a few years ago. Anthrobots are a new type of nanobot built and programmed from human cells, a nanoscale biological machine. In their groundbreaking research, Gazem Gumiskaya, Angela Tung, and Michael Levin show that they are able to repair neural fissures in brain tissues using these programmed biobots. These are living machines that they built without altering any DNA. They harness the power of bioelectricity, shining a light on the previously hidden to us collective intelligence of biological systems. This is such a radical shift in thinking about biology and nature that it's opening a whole new field of research and development: synthetic biology. But medical applications are only the beginning. This is the marriage of biology with engineering to not only understand, but also redesign the natural world. Imagine a future where you can plant a seed and grow a building.
Is that building alive? Yours are dead?
But how does this work? And most importantly, what does any of this have to do with sunglasses?
So I thought that this is crazy. Like, I'm not doing anything to the genome, but all of these different defects are forming. And the only thing that's different is the number of embryos in a cohort.
Whenever I hear a scientist use the phrase, "this is crazy," my ears perk up. Angela here is describing her research where her team applied teratogens to a frog embryo with a goal to stress and hinder its normal development. This predictably led to defects in the development of the organism. What was unexpected, though, was what happens when you apply the same level of teratogens to a group of embryos.
These larger groups are able to help each other out. So if you're being stressed out by the teratogen by yourself, you're not really sure how you're supposed to handle it, and so you're unable to handle it. Versus when you're in larger groups of, let's say, like 100, you have others around you that may be able to handle the stressor and can give you little packets of information like, hey, this is how I handled it, and now you too can survive the stressor.
Bioelectricity facilitates a form of collective intelligence among the embryos, enabling them to collaboratively navigate developmental challenges.
There's this phenomenon called wisdom of the crowds, and it's there used to be this old thing where they'd be in stores, there'd be this giant jar of jelly beans, right? And people would try to guess how many jelly beans. And so the result there is that every individual person is quite off, and nobody has any idea how many jelly beans are there. But if you just average all the guesses, it turns out that the crowd is spot on.
So is that what's happening here with the frog embryos? Group wisdom facilitated by bioelectricity? Well, the real story is much more complex and much more interesting.
If you were to compose a group of some embryos that were exposed to teratogens and some embryos that were never exposed, the simple model would suggest that it would actually work quite well, because the animals that were never exposed to the teratogens, well, they have a very good idea of how to make their body and their organs, and they should do a great job of informing the others of any information that they might be missing, right, in terms of that teratogen. But it turns out that actually that doesn't work. You need the optimal effect is when everybody was affected by the teratogen, and it's the result of having confronted this influence and having overcome it that is actually what's necessary. Everyone has to have seen it in order for the group to know what to do.
This is an extremely potent point that has far-reaching implications that we'll dive deeper into in a bit. But in order to fully understand how Gazem and her team leveraged this discovery to create their self-building, self-replicating biobots, we first need to dive into the language of bioinformation exchange. God observed the city of Babel and their tower that could reach the heavens, and realized that nothing they planned to do would be impossible for them when they spoke one language and worked as one people. To disrupt their unity and halt their project, God confused their language, making them unable to understand each other. The story of the Tower of Babel captures what it felt like to be early humanity, finding itself having to share a world with itself. As we explored and discovered parts of ourselves from faraway lands with very different customs, different languages, and different ways of understanding the world. We had to grapple with our inability to communicate and understand each other. Right now, I am flapping my vocal cords together to create vibrations in the air. I'm hoping those vibrations are picked up by this microphone here, which will convert those sound waves into electrical signals, which is then converted into light, an electromagnetic wave that the camera over here will pick up and record as ones and zeros on the flashcard. The underlying structure in that cascade of communication is our shared language. It's the glue which binds us together. It is the way I am able to take an idea in my mind and using sound and light, transfer it to your mind. Our language emerged from our social cognitive ability to understand and empathize with each other, forming an intricate web of shared meanings and experiences. As our societies grew more complex, so too did our languages, evolving to meet the ever-expanding needs of our civilizations. From this perspective, language becomes not just a tool for communication, but a driving force in the evolution of our culture. This is where the work of Gizem Gumeskaya and her team becomes revolutionary. They've shown that, akin to the way human languages evolve and adapt, biological systems too have their own dynamic forms of communication.
Biological structures have embodied computational frameworks that determine their architecture and their function.
But instead of sound and light, these systems rely on bioelectric signals and molecular pathways. Gizem and her team took tracheal cells from the human airway, a type of progenitor cell, and manipulated them, again, without altering any DNA, to become little brain-repairing biobots. The cells in our airway are progenitor cells, which gives them a degree of plasticity, meaning they can go from adult cells back to embryonic cells in order to become any cell they need to become to support the human airway. Understanding that, the challenge becomes how to get the cell to form the structure we are interested in.
What information do you need to give to these cells, and what interface can you use to get your goals across to the cellular collective? And that, I think, is critically important for unlocking the promise of regenerative medicine.
By decoding and manipulating the language of biology, Gizem and her team were able to guide the Anthrobots to perform hyper-specific tasks. It's as if they found a way to speak to cells, using their language to direct their actions. Let's take a step back and think about this for a minute. The fact that you have tracheal cells sitting in your body for decades, just doing their thing, wafting particles up and down your airway. The fact that if liberated from their environment, if exposed to the right language, they now have the ability to go around repairing defects in other types of cells. This is a generalized form of intelligence that exists at our cellular level, a monumental discovery that serves as a microcosm for our everyday world.
Having had to be exposed to the teratogen before you become helpful as part of the group, like, maybe there's a human analogy too. You know, Mark Solms told me that to be a good psychoanalyst, you have to have been psychoanalyzed yourself, right? And gone through that process. So maybe this is truly scale-free in the sense that you see it in cells and tissues and all the way up.
The mighty Mississippi River connects New Orleans to 32 US states and 2 Canadian provinces. It drains the largest river basin in the United States. Just like the river, language flows and evolves from wildly different sources to create a rich and diverse culture that would not otherwise exist. New Orleans was literally built upon the deposited sediment of the muddy Mississippi. And that rich diversity is reflected in the culture of New Orleans as well, culminating in the grand spectacle that is Mardi Gras. In their book, The Language Game: How Improvisation Created Language and Changed the World, Morten Christensen and Nick Chater argue that language is culture and culture is language. Our language is a symbiotic organism, parasitic on humans. It literally has a life of its own, evolving much, much faster than our DNA. It does this through countless low-level interactions where a structure and a grammar emerge. As much as Merriam-Webster would like to be the authority on language, they are simply documenting what emerges naturally from our culture. I want to dwell on this for a bit because it reveals something profound about human thought frameworks and the information geometry we assume from having to interface with other minds external to our own. There are about 7,000 languages spoken around the world, and all of the languages differ in sounds and vocabulary, but most importantly, they differ in structure. Linguistic determinism is the idea that the grammar and structure of the language we use literally shapes the way we think. The Kuuk-Thaayorre live in Australia, and they don't use words like left or right in their language. They use cardinal directions for everything. They say things like, "Watch out, you got an ant crawling up your southwest leg." In fact, the way you say hello in Kuuk-Thaayorre is you say, "Which way are you going?" And the answer is, "North-northeast in the far distance, how about you?" As you might imagine, growing up in a society where at a moment's notice, you might need to be able to accurately report your current heading, it changes how you think a bit. It changes what you pay attention to in your everyday life. The Kuuk-Thaayorre people have navigational abilities beyond what we thought was humanly possible. In their culture, a child can easily navigate the world with their natural senses, whereas I rely on a network of GPS satellites orbiting the Earth to tell me where the hell I am. We used to make up excuses like, "Well, we don't have magnets in our beaks like birds do, and that's why we can't figure out which way is south." But it turns out that the environment that we develop in and the language we speak and are exposed to has an enormous impact on every thought we have. In this sense, one could view language as a prison, a prison for thought. And just like we are now able to build Anthrobots by adapting and controlling the environment and language a cell is exposed to, we are learning that our culture and society operate on very similar fundamental rules. In English, we can say, "I broke the vase." In many languages, you couldn't use that construction unless you did it on purpose and you succeeded. People who speak different languages will pay attention to different things depending on what their language requires them to do. Witnessing the same event, English speakers remember who did it, whereas Spanish speakers will remember the intention, that it was an accident. These ideas have enormous consequences today as we continue to develop ever more capable and complex large language models. The AI revolution brings to the forefront what has been lurking under the surface for millennia: the power of our language. When we train a large language model, we are training it on our human language, obviously. This means that the patterns, the ideas, and subsequently the thought processes that emerge in the artificial intelligence are fundamentally a reflection and amplification of ourselves. And just as the language we use and the environment we develop in shapes us, the data we train our AIs on make an enormous difference. Microsoft showed us with Phi-2 just how much the data makes a difference by training a very small model that demonstrates outstanding reasoning capabilities. They did this by using a larger, more capable AI model to create a curated dataset to train the smaller model. You could think of it like the larger model showing the smaller model how it thinks about things, sharing with the smaller model what worked for it in its own development. This is a very big deal because models, small models like Phi-2 and others like it, can run on low-end consumer hardware like sunglasses.
You should be seeing what I'm saying just transcribed for you in real time, kind of like subtitles for the world.
Do you see me?
Oh, sí, sí te veo.
Oh, I'm actually looking straight into your eyes, and it seems like you're looking right at me.
Oh, sí, sí, estoy viendo lo que está diciendo para allá.
This simple use case alone will break down millennia of language barriers, bringing all of us into a world of unlimited possibilities. Diversity of data and language leads to diversity of thought. The more varied and comprehensive it is, the more nuanced and effective intelligence becomes, whether it's artificial or biological. It is only in integrating many different varied perspectives that understanding is born. And it's through this shared understanding that we are currently positioned at a very unique time in history. Just like the embryos are stronger when they share information about their struggles, when they share how they overcame their teratogens, when the LLMs share how they think and reason, we are stronger when we work together and share our individual truths. Look, this isn't the first time we've been here before. Standing at the doorway to a new world. The story of the Tower of Babel exists for a reason. It captures the archetypes that define the human condition. The Great Library of Alexandria in Egypt was one of the largest and most significant libraries in the ancient world. Alexandria was the capital of knowledge and learning in the 3rd and 2nd centuries BC because of the incredible wealth of diversity of knowledge the library contained. Over time, however, the people lost sight of this value, culminating with the Great Fire, which destroyed the library in 48 BC during Julius Caesar's civil war. This story repeats throughout our history because it's a lesson we still haven't learned. We only survive and thrive when we do it together. It is when we embrace the teratogens of our brothers and sisters that we all find salvation. We are once again standing at a precipice, but this time I'm going to give you a new word, a new piece of language to put it all in context. Vesperance, the solitary emotion of wistful recognition of the present as a fading era, tinged with anticipation for an unrecognizable, transformative future. Vesperance is that bittersweet moment when you're driving through your quiet college town, windows down, and the air feels thick with possibility. It's the golden hour of an era, and you're acutely aware that you're riding the last rays of a setting sun. You look around and see the world in the simplicity of the now, cognizant of the tectonic shifts on the horizon. And in that instant, you're both a poet and a prophet. You feel a sense of loss for this beautiful, imperfect world that doesn't even know it's already a memory. Yet there's a thrill, a pulse of electric anticipation for the unfathomable future that's rushing toward you. Vesperance is the emotional echo in that liminal space where the nostalgia for what's behind you is tinged with the exhilarating unknown of what lies ahead. It's not just an emotion, it's a narrative, a story where you're both the reader and the protagonist, caught in the poignant pause between chapters, unable to resist turning the page. We can only enter this new world by letting go of the old. The time has come. The moment is now. Are you ready to evolve? Thank you for watching. If you want to dive more into the details of how AI is transcending human thought, watch this video to learn about OpenAI's breakthrough that got Sam Altman fired as CEO and then immediately rehired.